After the Beatles come to this country and break open the American market for British acts, there's literally a flood of British acts that come on to the scene in this country. It's as if what people saw in the Beatles were a band of British guys with matching suits and these mop-top haircuts. And since the British invasion was in fact a kind of a fad, you know, like a slinky or a mood ring or a hula hoop, really any British group that that looked kind of like, did kind of what the Beatles did, was good enough. And so all these groups were kind of lumped together as British invasion bands. Everybody had to have one. Everybody had to sign one. This is not so different than what we talked about happening with Elvis Presley in 1956 when he signed to RCA. All of a sudden, once RCA, a major label, got into the game with Elvis Presley, the other labels felt like they had to find somebody too. So Decca signs, Buddy Holly, Capitol signs. Gene Vincent, people like that. And so what we find happening is all kinds of groups flooding in now. Some of them we are ultimately forgettable in the sense that we study them as part of the British invasion. They had hits at the time, but they really weren't able to sustain any careers after that. Others, of course, continued to have success past the British invasion. Groups like The Who, The Beatles, The Rolling Stones, somebody like Stevie Winwood and Spencer Davis, The Yardbirds, who eventually morphed into Led Zeppelin. These groups continued to have success, but a lot of the others, Jerry and the Pacemakers, the Dave Clark Five, other Freddie and the Dreamers, these are groups that really are sort of consigned to the oldies file when you hear about their music. So really, what these groups were about is having the matching suits and haircuts, the obvious British accents. But you can begin to divide these groups, just for organizational purposes, into what we might call almost. We can divide them, almost all of them, this way. There will be a couple at the end of this sequence of videos that I'll talk about that don't quite fit the mold. But almost all of them can be divided into either Beatles-type groups or Stones-type groups. If they're Beatles-type groups, the songs emphasize the song and the vocals. It's a smoother kind of performance, maybe a lot more vocal harmony, and a more sort of professional sound to the recording. If they're Stones-type groups, there's more emphasis on a blues influence. Maybe the vocals are a little sort of grittier and that kind of thing. And maybe the production values are not quite as polished as the Beatles-type groups. This is just sort of a general way of dividing these groups out. Of the Beatles-type bands that we might talk about, there's Jerry and the Pacemakers, a group that was also from Liverpool, also managed by Brian Epstein, and also produced by George Martin. So they were in a stable of artists that Brian Epstein began to pull together after the Beatles' first success. There's the Dave Clark Five, a group that was run by the drummer, Dave Clark, who owned the rights to all the music, and somewhere along the line decided that as the years went by, he wasn't going to license that music to anthologies and to collected hits collections and things like that. And so go out and try and find a Dave Clark 5 CD or record online, at least a couple years ago. Last time I looked, I actually did find some, but it was very, very tough to do this because Dave Clark had basically pulled that music out of circulation. Why? I'm not quite sure. Maybe he's waiting for something. Who knows? Anyway, the Dave Clark 5 were an interesting group because they were the group John Lennon was afraid was going to overtake the Beatles. In those early days, it was always, who's going to eclipse the Beatles? Is it going to be this group? Is it going to be that group? Is it going to be this group? Nobody had the idea the Beatles were going to be as big as they were. And John was afraid that the Dave Clark Five, that was a group that he respected and he thought was pretty good and had something pretty special. Herman's Hermits was another one of these Beatles-type groups, led by Peter Noone, who I don't know whether he purposely emphasized his accent, but when you hear him sing Mrs. Brown, You've Got a Lovely Daughter, singing it as Mrs. Brown, You've Got a Lovely Daughter, like that, it's really obvious that it's a British singer. And maybe that's just the way he would have done it anyway, but it seems to sort of play on the Britishness of the British invasion. Herman's Hermits, Peter Noone has often said, after they signed everybody else, they finally got to the bottom of the barrel and we were them. The fact is, those Herman's Hermits records stand up pretty well. And Peter Noone has gone on to have a pretty good singing career. playing, you know, clubs and casinos and that kind of thing. Another group, Beatles-type group, the Hollies, featuring Graham Nash, later of Crosby, Stills, Nash, sometimes with Young, had a big hit, a couple of big hits. Bus Stop was a big hit for them, but also a song called Carrie Ann, which was actually a song about Mary Ann Faithfull, who we mentioned earlier as having had a hit with As Time Goes By and having been the girlfriend of Mick Jagger. So they wrote a song, but they didn't have enough guts to call it Mary Ann, so they called it Carrie Ann, as if that that obscured the meaning somehow. And then another of the last of these Beatles-type groups that I'll mention is Freddie and the Dreamers, who really were, a very kind of strange group. I mean, they really just had only the sort of minimal amount requirement to be a British invasion group. The guy Freddie, who was the lead singer, they had a song called Do the Freddie. I guess they were trying to create something like The Twist or something, and he would do the Freddie, and it looked suspiciously like a guy doing jumping jacks. So you've got this situation where they're on the Ed Sullivan Show, and you've got these all these guys sort of looking like Beatles, but the singer in the front, sort of with Buddy Holly horn rim glasses, singing a song called Do the Freddie, and sort of doing jumping jacks and running across the stage anyway. I talk about things that didn't quite make a historical mark. That might have been one of them, though we can see where they came from. Other groups, Chad and Jeremy, Peter and Gordon, these all sort of think of these as Beatles-type groups, really sort of focused on the vocals, focused on the song, not a lot of rough edges in those. And then against that, you've got groups that are Stones-type groups. Now, these Stones-type groups, influenced by blues, it turns out that a lot of people who were members of these Stones-type groups end up having pretty good careers after the British invasion into the late 60s and certainly into the 70s and beyond. The best example of Stones-type groups, of course, is the Yardbirds, who, as I mentioned before, take over at the Crawdaddy Club and then are managed by Giorgio Gomelsky, the first important guitarist in the group, though he wasn't strictly speaking the first guitarist in the group, was Eric Clapton, who I mentioned before quit the group while they were recording, after they recorded the first single, because it just was getting all too pop-oriented. He went to work with John Mayall and the Blues Breakers. That was gave Eric Clapton the real sort of badge of authenticity that has been part of his career and his appeal ever since. He was replaced by Jeff Beck. Guitarist Jimmy Page came in first on bass when the bass player in the group quit. Jimmy Page had been a session musician, was doing tons of sessions at the time, but decided he wanted to be in a band. So first he was on bass. Then they said, well, why have we got Jimmy Page on bass? Let's put him on guitar. So then it was Jeff Beck and Jimmy Page on guitar. They were actually buddies. They'd known each other for years. But the competition, well, that didn't work out. So Jeff Beck left the group, and Jimmy Page left with the group, stayed in the group. And he was sort of the one left standing when everybody else had quit the group, and there were still some gigs left over that they needed to do as late as 1968, 1969. And so he got some people together, this kid from the country, Robert Plant, and a drummer that he knew, John Bonham, and another session musician he'd worked with during his studio days, John Paul Jones, who put the group together. They were going to be called the New Yardbirds. But then they decided they would change the name to Led Zeppelin. And so you see, the Yardbirds really give birth to Led Zeppelin. And that's another story for another day, part two of the history of rock. The Animals, another Stones-type British band, although they weren't part of the London blues scene, important with Eric Burton on lead vocals. When they did House of the Rising Sun with the electric guitar and the organ, apparently Dylan heard that. And that was one of the things that made him think maybe he should use electric guitar more. That story we'll tell next week when Dylan goes electric at the Newport Folk Festival in 1965. Georgie Fame and the Blue Flames, not a group you hear much about except that they had John McLaughlin, the famous guitarist in the group, and Mitch Mitchell, who later ended up in the Jimi Hendrix experience. The Graham Bond Organization, which also had John McLaughlin for a time, Jack Bruce and Ginger Baker, those two, Bruce and Baker, who would team up with Clapton to form Cream later. The Zombies, a group that was run by Rod Argent, who would later have a group in the 70s called simply Argent. Zoot Money's Big Roll Band, featuring guitarist Andy Summers, who would later emerge in The Police at the end of the 70s, going into the 80s. And the Spencer Davis Group, which featured a young Stevie Winwood. By young, I mean like teenage Stevie Winwood. And his voice, of all these groups, the Rolling Stones included and all the Stones-type British bands, his voice, Stevie Winwood's voice, is the one that could most likely pass for actually being an African-American blues singer from the late 1950s. And what was funny is that it came out of a skinny little teenage kid, but there was that big voice on those Spencer Davis records. Maybe the other guy who could compete with him for this sort of sounding of authenticity would be somebody like Eric Burton. So when we think about the Beatles and the Stones, we can think about most of the other of these British invasion bands as either Beatles type or Stones type, and we have to be kind of liberal in the way that we think about that, because it's never going to work exactly, this categorization. But there are two groups that no matter how we stretch it, no matter how we try and do it, we can't get to work into the fit into these two categories. And those groups are the Kinks and the Who. And it's to those bands that we turn in the next video.